life explodes again with a painful wheeze. I lurch forward to stop myself drowning in vomit. The inside of my skull a membrane of glass paper and rock salt. The cervix a swollen knot of bruises, while my right ear shivers with the incessant high-pitched drone. A wave of nausea washes over me. I can feel the earth spinning, and I hear a low buzz behind the internal scream. I try to hold back a gobful of sick, but it explodes from the corner of my mouth, bilious, rancid. My lungs feel like a searing tourniquet, six sizes too small. They drive heave in tandem with the last dribbles of bile and sputum. A plume of mucus dislodges itself from the lung wall and clogs the back of my throat like a soft spider's web. My eyelids tear themselves apart, claggy and matted with lymphatic glue. A flare of burning light thrashes the cornea like battery acid. And God said, "Fear looks," and there was light upon the earth. Once again, I fall towards the prison of the body. As I come to my senses, the low buzz increases in intensity, and I realize that something is amiss. I don't even bother to ask what hit me. I'm simply relieved to be alive. I'm laid in the middle of a road. The air is icy cold, damp. The sky above me sliding past at an unnatural rate. The tarmac beneath me vibrating, humming. It almost feels like I'm on the back of a truck or on a boat, but I'm sure that I'm lying on tarmac. My eyes gain focus. I'm dwarfed by a large steel construction, spidery and oppressive, with thick iron cables crisscrossing the air in all directions. The cables screech like banshees, the spider rusted, graffiti-riveled, relentlessly raining a ferrous brown piss onto the platform. I struggle to my feet and look round. I'm completely alone, standing on a strange platform of road about 40 feet in length, gated at either end, the gates marked out by wood flares. The platform is hanging from a giant steel spider by the cables in a manner I can't quite fathom. I limp over to one of the gates and the sense of movement grows. A surge of panic, no, confusion takes over. I see the land mass of Locus Iri disappearing into the distance, an abyss of black water being stretched between us. The flares of light obscure my view, but I can see spiny judders of water escape from the depths, trying to pull me in. My perspective is shot to pieces. I can't work out where I am, but I know that I'm trapped. I hurry to the fire gate and look over the side. There the platform crawls slowly towards an unknown province, bleak and shrouded in a luminous fog. Below me the same watery abyss creases and folds the space between the platform and the shoreline, drawing me towards a bleak future, shriveling all hope in its wake. The spider straddles the river, and I'm on the ferry boat to Hades. One of the cables unhinges from the spider and whips through the air with a terrifying whistle. The platform shakes violently and lists to one side. The cable lashes across the platform like a cobra snake, missing my head by inches. The spider lets out a low metallic moan, and a heavy shower of ferrous goo splashes the road. Another cable snaps free and dive bombs the platform with a horrifying shriek, whiplashing the far gate and taking it clean off. The platform banks perilously, and I'm knocked from my feet. I roll down the platform and drop off the side. I hang on for dear life. I hook my arm around a rusty girder and I get a face full of iron filings. I am suspended about 15 feet above the water, which despite the ungodly weather, boils and bubbles beneath me. I hear the vicious crack of another cable breaking free and the platform swings violently. My legs teeter just above the rising tide of the Stygian waters. The platform sways forwards, backwards, side to side, up and down, moving ever closer to the foreign moon. And then I hear it. The infernal cacophony of Kargon, demon of the deep, speeding towards me. His arrival is heralded by the piercing screech of diving birds that swoop out of the sky to attack me. I am defenseless, open, ripe for the onslaught. The birds strike at my back and abdomen, ripping chunks of flesh clean from the bone. All I can do is hang on while the birds dive for me at will. They lash at my legs, goring the soles of my naked feet, cutting through the thin material of my pants. The surface of the river stabs the air like projectile vomit, the waves getting ever higher, almost consuming the platform and pulling it under. As suddenly as it came, the attack subsides, and an ominous silence befalls the spider. All I can hear is the low hum of the moving platform as it crawls steadily towards the shore, now less than 10 feet away. The silence is oppressive. And then a strange phenomenon occurs. The waterline drops about 20 clear feet, as though someone has pulled the plug from the river. It is as though Moses has arrived to part the seas, to guide me to a safe haven. And with these famous last words, the river rises aggressively upwards, a deafening explosion of water as Kargon launches himself through the air, a massive serpent, huge enough to cause an eclipse of the entire sky, a hellish yell rent from the bowels of the earth. Kargon leaps the entire platform, entangling itself with the remaining cables and crashes into the river on the far side. I watch him passively at this awesome sight as the shock of its implication takes a second or two to register. Kargon swims away downriver at lightning speed as the groan of the spider and its foundations begin to break free, caught up around the belly of the beast. The spider buckles to one side like the felling of a giant redwood. The platform rushes downwind, trying to catch up with the serpent. In the brief moment before the whole thing collapses, only to be dragged screaming off to the cemetery in the sea in Kargon's wake, I take my chances and leap into the drink. tongue and lungs liquefy. As I bump the bottom of the pond, I open my lips and feel the runny gloop of my innards waft aimlessly from my mouth.
Yeah.
pylon stands in the doorway, beckoning me in. My mind is mud, my body destroyed. I have traversed the most hostile land in the domain of the unknown. An abandoned ghost town where no soul, not even the damned, dare live. Across the swamp of zinc flats that stink worse than the seventh ring of hell. It began and ends with Pylon, Minister of Axis. Pylon stands in the doorway, beckoning me in. Stretches out her hand, and Earth walks towards her. Cylon of Earth are nose to nose. She is mirror, he her reflection. Pylon is woman. A black, bottomless scab dripping across the thin air of the basement. Demon lover. Succubus. Paracaresis. Her open door. Gateway unto death. chapter 13, verse 1, the Schillinger's test. Four nurses stand admiringly over a bowl full to the brim with my shit. A pale fluid, almost lime-coloured and thick. My limecordial feces. That came out of me. Go on, take a dip. It's lovely and warm.
What? Who disturbs my sleep? No, I don't want to, please. Leave me here to rest. I don't want to get out of bed. I don't want to swing for it. Anything but that. Snuggle up into the warm bliss, safe and sound.
Hold on, son. Get a good grip. You won't need it anymore. One nurse dips a pen into the mixture, gives a quick stir, draws the pen to her nose and drinks in the heavy scent. She passes it around the group. Nurse?
Nurse! Make goo-goo faces at me. Make me feel like a man.
Beyond the veil, there is peace. Earth lies on a hospital trolley, a snake of amber torches overhead, humming a metallic lullaby. The trolley crawls along an endless corridor. Pylon takes his hand and walks alongside. Pushing the trolley is a disfigured gimp with a spondylitic humped back. One side of Gimp's face is almost beautiful. A single straight Roman nostril, a heavy-lidded brown eye framed elegantly by clear, healthy flesh and a high cheekbone. The right side of Gimp's face, however, is a weeping hole, as though a virulent tumor or pustule had burst its banks and left a clammy crater. Gimp clings to the trolley as one would a Zimmer frame, the hump bending him over earth in a bow. The hump has a mind of its own, coughing up medallions of eggy phlegm like there's no tomorrow. Earth looks directly into the crevice. You can see all the way to the back of Gimp's throat, from the cauterized stump of his esophagus to the base of his brain behind the clipper-trimmed palate. The hole, whilst naturally sore, red and raw, is coated with a thin layer of basement dust, the incessant coughing thrown at mini clouds of crud and feathers. The bed mite scamps across the jellied matter of his cerebellum, and the gaping cleft of Gimp's right sinus splutters and snorts, expelling a meaty gobbet of snot.
Saying it's all gone wrong.
There, there now. Don't be scared, Mr. Earth. Once we've got you cleaned up, you'll be as right as rain.
But it's all gone wrong. I heard the doctor saying.
Don't be a saint. The operation was a complete success. We'll have you home in no time at all. Chocolate, tomato soup, chips and ketchup.
Home. Yes. I want to go home.
Just lie back and enjoy the ride.
Will it be different this time?
An ice cream? Think about all the things you've missed. Was I dreaming? In some ways, it's all a dream, isn't it?
So, what happens now? To be honest, I was pretty broken up when they brought me in. And there's still more to do. Vinegar and brown paper takes time to stick.
We managed to bolt the bits back together, Mr. Earth. We've located the motor room, but there's still an elusive 13th and final piece of meat. It'll be in there somewhere. Vinegar and brown paper takes time to stick. They'll keep you on fire, monitoring my progress. Or so they say.
Seem to be able to feel my arms and legs.
Oh, I wouldn't worry about that too much right now.
Can you hear me?
As clear as a bell. first things first. Let's get you out of those wet clothes. You look like death warmed up. Life goes round and round, Mr. Earth. What you've experienced today is what makes yesterday even. Then, you're not likely to know what that means until... well, next time. Am I dead? Of course not, Mr. Earth. This is only the beginning. Thank you.